So we can start. So thank you very much to all of you for joining this event, a new appointment with the Fujita Health University Bantane Alumni Association webinar. Today we have two speakers. The first speaker is Professor Majid Sami. We are really honored to have Professor Sami here with us. It's a real chance to learn a lot from a giant in neurosurgery. And I want to thank also Dr. Mari Kuzumi from Japan, a young neurosurgeon, a female doctor, and we are very happy to have you here and listen to your research. I want to welcome Professor Yoko Kato, our leader, and I want to thank Dr. Raja and also Dr. Liu for the organization help, and my co-moderator, Professor Ishu Bishnoi, which probably, yes, he's here. Hello, Ishu. First of all, I would like to ask Professor Kato to give some introductory words to this webinar before I introduce our first speaker. Thank you, Professor. Please unmute yourself.
It is my not only me, but also all of us, the great honor to welcome the Professor Majid Sami. He is, I think, most of the world neurosurgeon. He can be the mentor of ours, and also the speech, also the very high motivation to encourage us all the time, I think. We are very much looking for your very interesting theme. The topics, and also Kusumi Sensei, she's one of the great, maybe the future, very promising the lady neurosurgeon. I think he is doing lots of the scholars open surgery. We're much looking forward to your lecture as well. And also the Alexander, thank you very much for your very busy schedule. You're on the way back to the home. Thank you so much.
Hello. Hello. I'm in my car. So sorry, but I'm in time and I have internet. So it's okay. So good to see you. Yes. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. So the Albert Sensei, maybe you can start.
Yes, thank you, Professor Kato. So our first speaker really doesn't need any introduction. Any introduction would be not appropriate. He is a giant in neurosurgery. He is the president of the International Neuroscience Institute in Hanover, Germany. Professor Majid Sami will talk today about a very, very interesting topic, actually, that would be useful for all young neurosurgeons of our audience. It's the management of facial nerve in neurosurgery. Thank you, Professor Sami, for joining. And please, you can start your lecture.
Thank you, Dr. Feliti, for organizing such an education program. I, of course, thank my dear friend, Professor Yoko Kato, who is really investing a lot of time of his life for distribution of education in all over the world. And I admire her so much. And that is the main reason I was ready to make this lecture on Sunday for our colleagues. But nevertheless, as you mentioned, I have decided a topic which is not very well considered among the neurosurgeons and also in all over the world. And it should be in future probably more considered and also more respected during the neurosurgical activities, because the loss of facial nerve function is a disaster for everybody, from beginning in the morning up to the evening to sleep, with all the disasters that a patient with a facial nerve has every day is a face. It cannot go to the public to the society, and is also the, it is has many many, I would say, negative aspect to the life of such a patient. We should consider this fact, and that was my personal motivation in very early beginning. As I started to develop peripheral nerve surgery, I was focused into the facial nerve, what I can do that all patients has a chance to have some restoration and some improvement of their face appearance and function, both of them. Now, I will start, I will share with you my presentations. Okay. And now we are, I think, you can see my...
Yes, Professor. We can.
Wonderful, wonderful. So let us start first some general questions. What is the pathology of facial nerve lesion? Sometimes we don't know it. We have to search. Mostly the tumors, they can arise from tumor for facial nerve, which is rare, but the majority of lesion in neurosurgery dependent on surgical activity with the tumors around the facial nerve in place, then also in petrous bone, as well as in the face. Hemorrhage is one of also the region, trauma, malformation, vascular compression, inflammation, and as I mentioned, surgery. The location of the lesions are first, of course, beside of supranuclear lesion, which come by a stroke and so is a partial palsy, is started with the facial nucleus, which is located in pons, and along in CP angle through the internal auditory canal, then enter into the petrous bone. And in the petrous bone has different area, and then came out through the stylomastoid from and out to the face, through the parotid gland, and then also distribute from the head, forehead, and also in all part of the face. Now, my personal experiences with reconstruction, of course, I have seen facial nerve at least more than 10,000 times, at least in 5,000 acoustic and many, many other tumors, skull base. But in 700 cases, I have reconstructed the facial nerve in different lesions. That is what I am going now to show you in the in my presentation. But before we want to start any treatment for a patient, we have some questions. One is to know for the surgical indication, what is the site by neuroradiological examination, by neurophysiological examination, and then what is the pathology of the lesion is very important. And the question which we have to put on the table is, is it complete? If complete, for how long? And very important is we have to ask the neurophysiologist about a spontaneous muscle activity, because this is the precondition to achieve a good result if the muscle is changed into the fibrosis. And of course, we can make reconstruction of facial nerve, we will not have any result. And this is also very, very important that you have. I will come back to that. Let us start with a nuclear paresis. This is very common by intrapontine bleeding by cavernoma, this lady, and mostly they have a trias. One is facial abducens and some hemi-symptomatic when we have such a bleeding. And abducens paresis is also has to be also treated. In one of my publications 25 years ago, I have published about 60 intracranial cavernomas, which had 27 of them intrapontine bleeding. And interesting is, this is a very important message with this slide, that with with the intrapontine cavernoma, when they are bleeding, we can have deficit in the 3rd, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, and the caudal cranial nerve. And what happened with all these cranial nerves? When we look, for example, the third nerve, at the end with follow-up, there was no, they were recovered. That is what is our experience. In 5th nerve, from 4, 1 remained partially. And their 6th nerve, you see, they have been in this material 13, and they started to recover mostly. And we have done, in these cases, as you have seen, we did a correction with the muscle, lateral muscle of the orbit, to shorten, to create a symmetric position of the eye. And the 7 is, of course, the majority of lesions we have in cranial nerve. And in these cases, when we see here that we had 13 cases, 1, 2, even bilateral. And if you look at this post-operatively, of course, you can have a temporary deficit, which is what was here, not 11, 4 more. And you can see that we had 2 cases only recovered, rest recovered, and we have also tried to help this patient with hypoglossofacial anastomosis. Interestingly, in the 8th nerve, the cochlear nerve has never ever recovered. When it was gone, then was gone forever. But the vestibular nerve was from 7, only 3 had still clinical symptoms. Now the caudal cranial nerve, fortunately, they are recovered very well. It is temporarily recovered very well. Only 1 case had some deficit. This is a very important, and I show you now the an example of the intrapontine, that is the floor of the 4th ventricle, and you're bleeding, the bleeding is gone, and you see the nucleus is forever disappeared and is damaged. And in this case, at that time, in the beginning, also in 17, 18, I used the end-to-end anastomosis of the hypoglossal nerve with a very, very good result. That is the same patient. You can see here that we have good closure of the eye and symmetric position. Symmetric position of the face, and also the abducens is corrected. In schwannoma, also in CP angle, of course, we have to try our best to preserve the facial nerve. You can see, but I will show you now some how to preserve it in internal auditory canal. Very important is that you open the internal auditory canal as long as you can, with preservation of semicircular canal. But very important is also enucleate, even in the internal auditory canal first, then try to separate the capsule from the facial. You see, this is enucleation in internal auditory canal. The pressure is gone, and then it is, of course, then more simple to separate than here. You can see how nicely. The other thing is, of course, three-hand surgery and also the arachnoid membrane. You have all never touched the facial nerve, always touch the arachnoid to the tumor, and then try to separate the nerve. This is the precondition to be successful almost in all cases which have perhaps are in size less than 3 centimeters. Today, really, I cannot believe if you do this surgery in that way, when the tumor is even less than 3 centimeters, why we should sacrifice the facial nerve? And we have at least to preserve the anatomy of the facial nerve, even the patient has a temporary weakness, then then will recover very well. And you can see here also, even you have seen here, the arachnoid membrane. I show you this because it, this is very important for the young people to see that and see this is possible. And if you don't find on one place the arachnoid membrane, leave it and go to other place, and then you come back to the area. And then you will see that that is possible to preserve. This is something that really I am convinced about that, and I'm sure every neurosurgeon is able to learn it and to do it and then preserve the facial nerve. That is the key point for neurosurgery in acoustic neuroadenoma. Preserve the nerve, and when you stimulate at brainstem, then you have it. I usually close the internal auditory canal with fat tissue, nothing else, because fat doesn't create fibrosis and is a very soft and not compressing, and with the fibrin glue. And these patients are very, very happy after surgery when they. And you see, cerebellum is almost not untouched, because the ENT colleague said a long time that when the neurosurgeon operate, then they destroy the CPN. I don't see any reason that the CPN, the cerebellum can have some. That is a patient immediately after surgery experiences a normal case. In larger tumor, but also in these cases, the so-called three-hand surgery, enucleation is key point. I go a little bit faster because I have to explain many things. And again, look here, arachnoid membrane. After, of course, enucleation, if you don't know enucleation, it is a sticky sore, and the irrigation. You see, never I use by blood coagulation from beginning to the end. If it is bleeding, the bleeding is cleaned by irrigation. And this is one of the best discoveries I had in my life for those tumors in CPA-ANGLE, to use the three-hand surgery, the assistant permanently. And then another thing is, once we have the tumor at brainstem, in internal auditory canal, we have to elevate the tumor to see the caudal border of the facial nerve, not to continue the nerve from internal auditory canal to brainstem, from brainstem to internal. This is wrong, and you will be destroyed. Still, we don't see here, but we have to elevate and see the arachnoid membrane and work on. Yeah. Now we can see here the border of the facial nerve, and then you can, of course, successively, you can then reduce the size of the tumor, and then of course you can see with enucleation better the arachnoid membrane, and so that you can elevate them here and then remove the tumor much here. The tumor is elevated, and you see this is the most adherent part. Even when the tumor elevated at the end, then here that is the arachnoid membrane. We can cut it this and this I showed you in order to say how important it is to learn the technique in order in acoustic neuroadenoma to preserve in the majority of cases than the facial the facial nerve. This patient who had osteichondritis was a significant weakness, but 4 weeks later, we see the patient was recovered very well without any problem here. That is the same patient after 4 weeks. Yeah, we have tried to make a classification in Hanover for vestibular schwannomas T1 to T4. And I have evaluated our recent cases in Hanover the last 20 years. And we have seen that if the tumor is T1 to T3, that means less than 2 centimeters, almost in every case, the facial nerve has been visualized and also preserved in continuity. By giant tumors, it is completely different. You see, 92% I was able in giant tumor, and the rest we have per either we could have a very light a capsule over the nerve, or we had to reconstruct the nerve. You see here, even the size of tumor doesn't mean that the tumor should be. The facial nerve has no chance. Now, and you can see here after enucleation of this tumor, here we can see the facial nerve at brainstem preserved and the patient immediately after surgery. Many of the, at least 50% of these people have a good, fantastic function. But another part, they can have some weakness during the next 4, 5, 6 weeks after surgery, because the nerve is elongated, that they need time for recovery. Here, another example, but you can see that is also less than 3 centimeters, and even the hearing can be preserved in such a sense. This is even the hearing is improving, this little girl. And this patient with this huge vestibular shot, look at the brainstem, and the tumor is internal, was removed, and you can see the facial nerve, and she's a photographing and photographer and working a couple of years after this operation in our department as photographer. And here another example of this large tumor, a medical doctor, we see that also the hearing could be preserved in this area. But in bilateral acoustic, can you imagine if the patient has on both sides facial nerve palsy? This is a disaster. And this is a Korean patient with a hearing loss completely on the right side and still some good hearing on the left side. We have operated the right side. You can see here, right side is completed. That is the tumor on the left side. We didn't want to operate this, but the family pushed us and we have then removed this. Fortunately, we could preserve the hearing, as you see. And the facial nerve, you can see here on both sides, is preserved. He can also hear. He can close the eyes. Without any deficit. Okay. Now, what happened in cases that the nerve cannot be preserved? I recommend to all neurosurgeons, please take a small part of the sural nerve and you can then reconstruct sural nerve in CPNG. That is the most easiest part. And here you can see this example, reconstruction of this here in CPNG. And the patient, you can see, about 5 months after this, 9 months after the surgery here, and 15 months, you see the symmetric position. The result is really very, very good, and you can expect always a good result when you reconstruct the nerve. If we have no distal stem, before I have introduced this intracranial, intratemporal in 1975, the Norman Dodge in England, he did the first 1, 2, 3 cases of intracranial extracranial in front of a stylomastoid foramen. I show you, that is my first example, which I operated in 1975. Here, that is the central stem, that is the graft, and in front of the sigmoid sinus, we make a hole through the dura and take it into fallopian canal. We make a mastoidectomy, and that is the graft, and that is the facial nerve in fallopian canal. And I use in the past, always a suture, but many, many years, more than 25 years, I am just using the fibrin glue here. The patient with complete facial palsy, and 18 months later, that was my first patient. Can you imagine when he came to me? He was from Nuremberg, came to me, and I saw how happy I was and how enthusiastic I was to continue my work on facial nerve with the nerve grafting. Here, you can see this technique in a video. This lady was operated somewhere else, and that's as I have received many such cases after surgery in other places when they have the facial palsy, then they came to me. And you can see that I was able at brainstem to find the central stem of the nerve here. And then I have also made the mastoidectomy. And I go very quickly here. And after this mastoidectomy, you can see very well the facial nerve in fallopian canal. And then I make a hole through the dura here and then take the sural nerve. That is the CP angle. And that is the mastoidectomy. And now the nerve is coming from CP angle to the mastoid. And then I anastomose, of course, first in this here. Important is you put some fibrin sponges in to feel the CP angle that the nerve can stay stable. As you see, that is a neuroma which we are removing. And then that is the graft come here. And you see when you have the fibrin sponges there, and then you put just the fibrin glue, that is enough. The same fibrin glue, we use it in fallopian canal here. That is, here is the geniculate ganglion. Under the geniculate ganglion, we transect the nerve, turn it to the side because the facial, the graft is coming from this area. And then we make the adaptation of the bones. And here, wonderful. And then you put then fibrin glue and mostly I close the hole with the fat tissue where you can see that. And here, just I show you another example. That is the CP angle, that is standard. Here, this lady I operated, I think 2021, she was operated another clinic with partial removal and complete facial palsy. And she came to us, and here you can see still the tumor. And this is a, and then she came 2-3 weeks ago for control. That is the still existing tumor. And I mean, this was complete facial palsy as she came 2021 to me. And then here you can see that I go very quickly. This is of course, lots of scar, but interesting is that we opened the internal auditory canal, which was not opened by the operation. And now I have here, I removed the tumor completely and then identified the facial nerve. Yeah, this is the facial nerve here. And then I had to go to CP angle. Yeah, there was a scar and you see the facial nerve was attaching to the brainstem and I have tried to separate it. And here. And now there is a neuroma. The neuroma is cut. That is the facial nerve, central stem of facial nerve. And now I take a graft, I put between the central stem and then, this is direct reconstruction in the internal auditory canal. And now we get the graft. Yeah. Now is a graft, that is the end of facial nerve. at the internal auditory canal and at brainstem here. That is the brainstem, and that is the graft. And you see the fibrin sponges here holding the fish. This is a wonderful picture for learning. And this patient, 2021, I operated him over 2 weeks ago in my office, and I was happy to see that that, and of course, I closed the internal auditory canal always with fat tissue to avoid any fistula after through the mastoid cells, which are of course mostly available here. And this is the situation after done, of course, after fat tissue. I can tell you the fat tissue is the best tissue existing in the human body for so closing any area and for modeling any area. I use it also in many glioma, in many, many cases of the neurosurgery when there is a hole and the hole, I want to close it and avoid the scar tissues. And you see that is now everything is closed, and you can see the patient thing 2 weeks ago to me. You see the symmetric position is achieved in this patient. He was so happy because he was suffering 2 years with a complete difficulty. And she is able also to close the eye, and she was really very, very happy with this result. And you can see when the people don't learn to remove the tumor and preserve the facial nerve, what happened to this patient? That is not acceptable. I show that to young people, they should see it is possible to help this patient, but not is also possible to hurt the patients, both of them. And so I think this is just what we have already seen. I show you now examples also some of such disasters. This is a patient who came from Santiago de Chile for many years ago. And she had two surgeries of CP angle tumor, also a vestibular schwannoma. And after the tumor was growing, received radio surgery. And then he received a steroid therapy. And therefore you can see the face, and she developed a Cushing syndrome. And she came down, but the surgeon himself, he sent the patient to me. This is very honest of him. And she came to me. And what I have done, I have of course seen this tumor, which was a completely compressing the brain stem to the other side as fourth ventricle. The tumor, despite of two operation and radiotherapy, it was possible to remove it completely with preserving the brainstem, and also the hemiparesis recovered. And then 2 weeks later, I have done hypoglossofacial anastomosis. I will show you here. You see here, that is the hypoglossus, and that is the facial nerve. And I used the 50% of hypoglossus, and I have to do here a mastoidectomy and expose the facial nerve in the fallopian canal in order to have the links to bring it down and anastomose to the hypoglossus nerve. The advantage of it is that patient don't develop any atrophy of the tongue. And here is the exposure of the facial nerve, as you have seen in other surgery. And here we cut it and bring it down. And we transect here 50%, and then we make the end to site anastomosis. Here you can see in video very nicely. This is the facial nerve. This is the hypoglossus nerve. And now we start to open. Here is the mastoid, and we do the mastoidectomy here. And here you see the facial nerve. We transect under the geniculate ganglion, and we bring it down. And then after having a very smooth surface, and you can see that that is the hypoglossus nerve. So I take the seizure and 50% of hypoglossus nerve is transect, and then we suture that to the hypoglossus nerve. And with this, and of course, we can then have, we can achieve a wonderful result. I will say in this patient, I will show you then how beautiful that was. This lady came about 1.5 years later in my office. I couldn't recognize her because the Cushing syndrome was gone. The paresis was also improved, and the facial nerve also has created the symmetric position of the face. But if you don't believe this is the patient, I show you here. If you look through the eyes are the same, but the face was different before surgery. That was the tumor. Tumor is removed here, and you can see here also the tongue. The tongue
now
here can move to every direction.
Close your eye.
You see, can close the eye.
Close.
And now here. You can see that wonderful is
open
on and then the
open.
And the tongue.
And can you show me your tongue?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then
okay. Okay, now straight. So
yeah, here. No. And of course, this is a wonderful technique. Without any lesion, you create again a good bone. I show you another disaster of surgeries. That is a 44 years from Holland. And the patient, before admission to our department, he has received from this tumor a biopsy and cyst puncture, not the removal of the tumor. And as the cyst become larger and larger, they performed a cystoarachnoidal shunt. Can you imagine them? Cystoarachnoidal shunt. And then the cyst was still growing, and they did stereotactic cyst puncture into reduction. As all this not working, they did a gamma knife. And the patient came to us with this condition. He couldn't walk and was imbalanced, vertigo aggravated, dysplasia, and dysphagia, and double vision in all directions, complete hearing loss on the right side, facial, partial facial palsy. In this condition, he came to us. That is the tumor. You see the condition of brainstem here with the cystic part, and that is the solid part. Finally, I show you this operation because this is so important. You see how many scar was there. And then we have tried to, yeah. That is the shunt, as you see, this tube. And the tube was sticking with the tumor. And that was a surgery for itself. First, you see that was sticking. And that I have tried to separate this shunt because I was afraid about facial nerve. I wanted to preserve the facial nerve. And so that, anyway, I was in this car trying to find a way without hurting anything. That is the tumor, what you see. And that was the cystic part. Now, now the shunt is out, and then we start to remove the tumor. I go very quickly through that because of time. You will see I have to open the internal auditory canal as well here. And then finally, we can see that I could then, after enucleation, I could then see the capsule and separate the capsule from brainstem. And then finally, there is a preserve the facial nerve here at the end of the operation. Yeah. You see? That is the facial nerve. That's arachnoid. The tumor was completely removed. That is the abducens nerve, as you see here, abducens nerve. And this patient, of course, after our surgery, has recovered very well. And you can see the post-operative MRI, complete removal. And the patient, 9 months after surgery, you can see here, wonderful recovery, and gave a very nice talk, but I don't want to show you. He came then later, 1.5 years later, with an absolutely balanced, but normal patient, started to have a normal life. Of course, in children, the trauma is, of course, can the transection of the petrous bone can create facial palsy. In this child, I have done also the intracranial, extracranial anastomosis, as you can see. That is the exposure of the tumor CP ankle. That is the fallopian canal, the same operation as you have seen, just in this case also. Another example of patient who had a lesion in petrous bone, but sometime because of retrograde degeneration of the central stem, there was a neuroma in CP angle. And 3 times he was operated in petrous bone unsuccessfully. Finally, we have operated this patient here, made the anastomosis between the brainstem and petrous bone. And you can see, even after 3 years paresis, he recovered very well. Now, when we go further and see that sometimes the tumor can originate from the facial nerve, and the facial neuroma has to be operated and the nerve has to be reconstructed. This is my personal statement that that we have to operate in these cases also early, with early diagnosis and early surgery, that they get the tumor is removed, and the nerve reconstruction will then create then good function. You see that in 2001, I have published my paper about this, and there's other publication. And this is a classical CT scan of the facial nerve roderoma, which is also in the petrous bone and create there. And they're all the tumor which are in CP angle at any places like here. But look, please see that, how is the destruction by facial nerve schwannoma, destruction of the petrous bone. You can see the petrous bone is enormously destructed. And in this case, of course, that was the patient with the facial palsy before surgery. And you see the tumor is completely removed, brainstem, and that is the reconstruction of the nerve defect. And the patient, about 1.5 years later, you can see how beautifully this reconstruction helped. Another example of facial nerve in huge tumor, which has been also completely removed, as you see here. And this is also a facial nerve in the very interesting, in the intramural and intertemporal extension. Look at that. This is really a very exceptional situation. Unfortunately, it's a very complicated operation because the tumor was here in the middle fossa, extending into the internal auditory canal. But I couldn't go only to CP angle and do it. I have to go in the middle fossa. I go very quickly, and then I had to open the internal auditory from above, from the roof. And that is the tumor part in CP angle. And therefore, I have tried to close this hall because of fistula with fat tissue. And then I transected is in the healthy area with a graft. I anastomosed there and brought this graft into the fallopian canal and anastomosed with the fallopian canal. And I go a little bit faster because of the time, unfortunately, I cannot. You see, with the fat tissue, we had to make sure that, and now I am cutting the tumor in this area. And that is the end of the facial nerve. That is a central stem here in the middle, in the internal auditory canal. And that is the graft, which we bring it to the central stem. And then we fill, we put some fibrin glue and then put again fat tissue. And when this is stable, then I go to the fallopian canal here. Now is everything closed in hidden fossa. That is the fallopian canal after mastoidectomy. And here the graft is coming to the fallopian canal. And this is the facial nerve in fallopian canal. And we anastomose that together. This is a very interesting, very fine surgery, which I wanted just to show you that you see that. This is a tumor in fallopian canal. It started here. And as you see, we have removed this tumor, and then is a graft between here, facial nerve, and here, stylomastoid foramen. And that was an open center, and she has recovered very well and could also continue. In face, of course, we have also here tumors originating from facial nerve in the face. And here, this is a very nice example to see that also here we can remove this tumor. I go very quickly, remove this tumor, and then reconstruct facial nerve as well here. You see that is the tumor is completely removed, and I have removed here auricular magnet for grafting between the facial nerve periphery, and because the central stem was not yet available, I used here the hypoglossus, that is a hypoglossus nerve. I did the same surgery, and that is the graft between hypoglossus nerve, and I brought that to the ramus masticatoris, and that is a very, very, very important branch, which creates a very nice stem result. I will then go on, because another example of a neurofibromatosis in face, I operated that already at the University of Mainz many years ago, you see, and then reconstructed the facial nerve. And 17 years later, he came to Hanover to me and had such an extension of tumor in 13,000, you know that. And also the graft was tumor, and so that I have to open again and remove all these tumors. Yeah, as you see, I make a transection of mandibula in order to reach all the tumor. This is an alveolar mandibular nerve through the alveolar bone, as you see here. And this is all tumor has been removed completely. That is the tumor you can see here. And then I did again another reconstruction of facial nerve, which has created also some function. In malignant tumor of the external ear with the carcinoma, here, of course, the people have to do a radical neck dissection and removal of the tumor radically. And in these cases, I have, of course, tried to reconstruct the facial nerve as well as the accessory nerve is reconstructed here. Parotid gland tumor. I remember in Mainz, I had received so many such patients. Because of facial nerve, I had to remove the parotid gland as neurosurgeon and reconstruct also in the same time the facial nerve, as you see here. And this is the after lesion on here that reconstruction. As I had in my life complete education for plastic reconstructive surgery, in this case, and also in many other cases, I have learned how we can do rotation flap. In this case, the skin was also, the malignant tumor was involved, and I had to make a complete resection here. And then I made a flap, a special flap with also vascular connection to close the, and first I reconstructed the facial nerve and then make this rotating flap as you see here. And this patient here, you see after 1.5 years with a wonderful facial function and also cosmetically is not, I was not a bad plastic surgeon. Yeah. When we have a lot of graft after removal of the parotid gland and we have here scar, normally you cannot find the central stem and it is better you make a mastoidectomy, open the facial nerve and expose in a good healthy and bring it to the different branches with a graft here as you see. And the results are really very nice, as you see here in this particular. That is a special case I show you. 19 years old student at the University of Mainz, I operated this case in 1971. It is already more than half a century. And she was operated as she was a baby of 5 months, And from 5 months until 19 years, she had this facial palsy. As she heard that I am working very hard on peripheral nerve, facial nerve, she came to me, asked me if I can help. I saw that and I said, perhaps let us have an electromyogram. We did an electromyogram here. We found a very interesting for me at that time phenomenon that the muscles here was not atrophied because we had a mixed innervation coming from here to the muscles here. Then I decided to do surgery and export and found the central stem in front of the stylomastoid and the peripheral branches. And then I reconstructed that. And look at that. It took a long time, 1.5 years until the function came. And I tell you that you can always try to make an electromyogram. Ask your physiologist, is there any mixed innervation? If there is a mixed innervation, you can also operate after 10 years, 20 years, patients. At that time, we introduced then that crossover anastomosis is from facial. You can lose 50% of the facial nerve on the healthy side. You have still a nice function. And the other 50% you can with a graft bring to the other side, as you can see here. Facial anastomosis. But it is a little bit weaker than the hypoglossus nerve, and therefore I have combined that, the facial with Lexer Rosenthal. That means I use two muscle strips from temporal muscles and elevated them on the lip here and also elevated the eyelid here also. And you can see that is the Lexer Rosenthal and the patient looked the image after surgery. The symmetric position is achieved. Eye is closed because of the muscle which I have here and also elevate here. And at the same time, we did also a crossover facial anastomosis. This is a very nice technique. And you see, she has also after 1.5 years emotional function. This is another example. I have operated many such cases as a result of that. I see my time is long over. I have an enormous evaluation. I've published so many papers about the results of all these things. I don't go to the results because the result is not now for you important, but you can see so many slides I have for you. I had for you to show you that how everything has been scientifically examined. And I say, now I close my lecture now and thank you very much for all your attention. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Sami, for this impressive lecture. where you showed it is actually possible to get terrific results with facial reconstruction, even in, I would say, extreme cases. So thank you very much. We can open the discussion at this point. I'm sure there will be many questions. I actually have many, but I would like to ask the audience if there are questions. I see there is a raised hand. Dr. Atiq Islam. Unmute, please.
I am Dr. Atiq. I am from Bangladesh, currently Fujita Fellow under Professor 𝑬𝒐𝒉𝒉𝒐. And it's our privilege to have the legendary neurosurgeon, Dr. Majid Sami, sir, among us. And it's our privilege to ask him some questions. First, I would like to express my gratitude to him for showing us so many interesting things. First, I should acknowledge his facial nerve reconstruction by Pipin Guru. It is a really interesting procedure. And my question is, have you any failed cases after doing facial nerve anastomosis by Pipin Guru or side-to-side anastomosis? My second question is, in our country, most of the vestibular sonoma is very giant. And sometimes it is very difficult to remove the total of the tumor. And in that case, we left some of the tumor that is firmly adherent to the facial nerve, where it is very thinned out. What should be our next step? Should we remove the total tumor and take preparation for anastomosis, or it is okay to leave some tumor? My second question is for identification of facial nerve after central decoding, from which side should we go? From internal acoustic meters or from brainstem? Which side we should try to trace the facial nerve? And my third question is, during the days of minimal invasive surgery, some neurosurgeons are trying exoscopic, endoscopic keyhole removal of the vestibular sonoma. So I am seeking your suggestion or recommendation about this exoscopic, endoscopic keyhole surgery for vestibular sonoma surgery. Thank you very much.
I'm sorry. Your first question, it was interruption of the voice. What was your first? Because you asked me about pain.
My first question is facial nerve reconstruction by fibrin glue. It is very amazing.
By what?
By fibrin glue. Fibrin glue.
Fibrin glue.
Do you have any failed cases after this type of reconstructions, or all cases are successful?
Yes. Okay. And first of all, very important question was what to do if some part of tumor is still over the nerve, but is sticking so much and you want to leave it. Yeah. Or you should cut it. Now, I would recommend to you that if really you have removed the tumor and you have just a little bit also over the livid, don't cut it and don't perform, because sometimes through the surgery and because the feeding vessels are gone, sometimes the tumor will not grow anymore. This part, this little part, perhaps over many, many, many years. And therefore, it is better for patient to have a good function than you cut it and wait for one and a half, 2 years to have a good results. That is this. And the other one, with a fibrin glue, I have videos that I started with with tin zero thread to suture, to make a suture of nerve, but it is almost more than 30, 40 years I stopped, and experimentally, one of my students made in Kaninship, in a rabbit, and two groups and compared together, this didn't see any differences. Also, we compared the first series of our cases with this series than with the group, no difference. Therefore, you can really use always fibrin glue. And What was your third
question was central geocoding of the tumor to identify the facial lab from which site
This is very good question, because either inside nor outside, both of them. First of all, if the tumor is large, you need to enucleate a little bit in order to be able to open the internal auditory canal. You have to reduce a little bit the size. And once you open the internal auditory canal, you have two choices. One is that enucleate, and you see you can easily expose the facial nerve. Yeah. And if you can, do it and not go to this brainstem, because you have already the facial nerve in your vision, you know. And then try to enucleate further, and at brainstem, try to find it. Enucleate, resect, go until you identify. Good. When you identify both, forget the facial nerve on both sides. Don't follow from brainstem, don't follow from internal auditory canal. That is a mistake.
It is.
If somebody start from both sides to force, the both goes to the middle of the facial. Try to enucleate, because you have already at brainstem, you have already internal clang, enucleate. And if you can, elevate the tumor from caudal part anyway, as long until you can see the border, the caudal border. This is very, very important advice I get. If you do that, really do that, you will be always successful. And then you can little bit from internal, then stop little bit from stop until you have completely the border of the facial nerve in the caudal. You are in Bangladesh.
Yeah, I am from Bangladesh.
Yes. You know, I think 20 years ago, 2 days lectures, I think 12 lectures, they are all in videos, and all Bangladesh neurosurgeons have that. Do you have it?
Yeah, of course.
I spoke about all topics in neurosurgery 2 days, from morning to evening, for all Bangladesh neurosurgeons. This is one of the 1,000 historical events I had in my life.
Okay.
I hope you have it. If you don't have it, go and take it.
No, we have it. My last question was, some of the neurosurgeons is choosing keyhole surgery for vestibular sonoma by using exoscope and endoscope for doing mini surgery. What is your recommendation?
I must tell you, I am sorry to say, but please tell them, the people who use really endoscope for acoustic in CP angle, they are trying to make something in order to get the cases. Because the patient, you say to patient, I am endoscopic, I don't operate. This is a little endoscope goes, and this is minimal invasive. The word minimal invasive is one of the, I would say, unbelievable, inacceptable words. What is maximal invasive? What is invasive? The word invasive is something that has to be really thrown out from the discussions. Which neurosurgeon should be invasive? Every neurosurgeon should be absolutely, welche neurosurgeon should be invasive? And it was, I cannot understand a neurosurgeon who start with a macroscope is very dangerous. If you make the endoscope, you are invasive. Now, in contrary, with endoscope, you are dangerous. because you have not with the endoscope, with the instruments that you have beside of endoscope, putting in CP angle, you have not that refinement that you need with your fingers to touch and to move, to hold. You don't have it. How do you want them to make such an excellent surgery? I'm hurried, you are, please, these people don't accept as neurosurgeon. They are not neurosurgeon because I have endoscope in every of my room. I am using endoscope in the majority of my, but I know at which, for example, in acoustic, ask me when I use the endoscope. I use it when I see I have not reached the fundus absolutely, or I don't want to go further. Then I take the 30 degrees endoscope and look inside and see if there is anything there or not. That is endoscope. If I have an epidermoid tumor, which is absolutely behind the cerebellar anatomy, then I have such videos I show in every Congress. But if somebody say, I operate acoustic neuroma only by endoscope, this man is dangerous. Please tell to everybody that I said that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for your suggestion.
Thank you, Professor Sami. We have other questions from the chat. Dr. Parekh is asking if it is possible to use fibrin glue also for hypoglossal facial anastomosis rather than stitching. Would it work?
It is very, very good question. Because the position of the facial nerve and hypoglossus nerve is the unnatural position, because you cannot hold it in that position without suture. At least two suture, the question is very important. Two suture, one right, one left side, the rest with fibrin glue. Very, very important question.
Thank you. And about, you mentioned about leaving a small remnant if this remnant is very attached to the facial nerve, and you said it's wise to leave instead of cutting the nerve and doing a graft. What's your policy in those cases? Do you observe or do you send them to radiosurgery?
No, not at all. Thank you for this comment, because first of all, this happened in my person, 1% of 100 acoustics when I operate. Perhaps in 1% I see really that I can do my best, but this capsule is sticking so that I have, but not that every neurosurgeon say, I leave always that. That is not acceptable to say that I leave it. But if the neurosurgeon has not enough experience, he should leave not only the capsule, he should leave also some part of tumor, not destroy the patient. That is perhaps not a bad answer.
Yeah. And observe.
And observe. Don't commonize.
Thank you. We have another question from the chat, from, I don't know the name of this doctor, there is only the number. Sir, in your experience, what is the usual or most common position of facial nerve in CP angle tumor, cranial, caudal, or medially located?
Yes, it's a very important question, but I can really tell you, there is never in medicine anything that you say never ever existing. But usually the facial nerve is located anterior and caudally. And this is my experience in 5,000 acoustic neuroma, that exceptionally, sometimes the nerve is going from not just anterocaudal, it can go also anterocranial, you know. This is also possible, not very rare, but that can go. But never posteriorly, that means when we enter into the tumor, we are not facing the facial nerve. Perhaps in 1,000 cases, in one case is the facial nerve posterior, but I cannot explain that why that the facial nerve, which is always anterocaudal, that when the nerve originating from vestibular nerve, how they can go behind the nerve and push the nerve backwards posteriorly. But I never want to be dogmatic and say never happened, that it can happen, but then we have to ask the God how he has created such an individuum to have the facial nerve posteriorly.
Right, thank you. I also have a couple of questions, Professor. The first one, you showed very difficult cases, maybe operated in other institutions, and where you had to reconstruct and with a graft the facial nerve. So is it always possible to find the facial nerve stump at the brainstem? Or do you have any memory when you couldn't find any stump? So what do you do in those cases? And my second question is, what do you think about using papaverine at the end of surgery just to reduce or minimize the risk for facial nerve weakness? Thank you.
You know, this is very, very important practical question. When the patient comes and has an operation, the tumor is partially or completely removed, the patient has a facial. You can never, before opening, be sure that there is a brainstem available or not in brainstem facial nerve. I personally speak at least half an hour with the patients and explain the entire problems and situation. I say, look, we don't need to go back to the CP angle. I can do hypoglossum. But of course, if we can do the direct reconstruction, is always from emotional things could be better. If you want, I can, but I cannot give a guarantee. That means I will look at that. If I find it, okay, I do it. If not, I do then for you hypoglossal. That is the only way. You have no other way to explain to the patients. You know? But if you can bring the patient to the awareness that CP angle exposure is a chance, then of course you can try to do that, you know, to go to the CP angle and look at that.
Yeah. And what about papaverine use?
Papaverine, you know, something that of course is not bad, you know. Anyway, you can do it, but I cannot really say that it is working or it's not working, but it's a good idea because in some way you try to help the facial nerve to have a good condition, you know.
Thank you, Professor. I would ask Professor Wozniak to give a comment, please.
Professor Sami, can you hear me?
Yes, of course.
Yeah, okay. Hello, Professor Sami. So good to see you again. And I want to start to say that I'm happy for the chance to say thank you for your contribution to the world neurosurgery and for your contribution to my education for growing as a new neurosurgeon. You remember I visited INIA many, many years ago, and you explained me a lot of about surgery of acoustic, and you showed me a lot of tricks of this surgery, and I use them every day in my surgery and remind you every time with gratitude. So thank you very much. I hope to see you in Prague in 2 weeks at the Masin meeting. I cannot comment you. It's impossible comment your lecture because your lectures do not need to be commented. But I have questions. I have questions. All the questions about time. First, you know, if you operate on the acoustic, you know about this very undesirable complication like a late facial nerve deficit. After 1 week, I had even one in 1 month. I had once I had in 1 month. What I'd like to have your comment about it, about reasons, because it's very discussable questions. So, and there are very unclear in this. Maybe I'd like to know your point of view.
Yes, this is, you know, first of all, I must tell you, you cannot imagine what a pleasure is for me today to see that I contributed a little bit for improvement of each neurosurgeon. You know, this makes my heart really very, very absolutely happy, because that was the goal of my life, not to keep for myself when I have discovered something. I wanted to give to everybody around the world without any limitation. And your comment now make me happy, I must say, when you say, and this is really, this is something that the young generation, they have to know that if they have learned something and they have an assistant, they have to give it further, and they will be always thankful for everything that you learned. I said in my life, as I was very young, people, I said, of course, in my family, my father, mother, is very important, but people that in my life gave me some advice and something that I could have a better life, they are for me like my father and mother, that they gave me the chance to educate. And therefore, I thank you very much for your comment. But for facial palsy, you have to tell to every patient when has a good function and leaving you from the hospital. Look, there are about 5% of patients, they could have 5 days, 5 weeks or so. I have also long-term that they call me and say, Professor, I was fantastic. Now today I have a facial palsy. But the fact is that all these patients recover again, old. I have not really, you have to follow these people, they recover. And your job is by phone, so don't worry. Perhaps you can tell them take a steroid, you know, for, but what is the cause, you know, of that? There is speculations that we can say, suddenly is a thrombosis for of nerve that of artery that is not, the blood supply is not good enough, and at a ischemic or the high pain. And it is very, very difficult to explain that. It is very, I would say, there is no possibilities to evaluate that. It is really not possible to evaluate this, and that is something that is exactly the same with the tinnitus, that nobody can explain. The nerve is cut, the nerve is gone. Okay, that is the stump of the nerve, but tinnitus. The nerve is kept, is preserved, is kept, but the patient has a tinnitus. There are something in, believe me, I tried to all details of vestibular schimmelomas to find something which can help us. But this question of you is correct. We cannot, in these cases, make any prediction, but we know that what I say, I'm convinced, every case recover.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And another one more questions about the vestibular schwannoma surgery in elderly patients, with patients in advanced age. How do you think, is the age by itself, is this the reason to be less radical in vestibular schwannoma surgery? Because I think no, because I had at least two cases after 17, after 80, but I was not radical. And then they operated on in 2-3 years radically, because I read the literature with recommendation. What is your option?
Yeah, that was for me many years ago, one question, and we have evaluated, we have published the paper. We have published paper not only for vestibular tumor, also meningioma, for CP angle tumor. We have taken people over 65 and under, and there was no difference, no difference, not at all. You are right, you are absolutely right. But that was the reason that we made such a, with my colleague, Dr. Garganov, we have published this paper with a large series of cases.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Why they should not? I believe I have the number of patients. I have operated last week, 181 years old. Man, he came to me, he's a professor. I know you will solve my problem, but I don't want to have it. And he has just yesterday left the hospital without any problem. Even his hearing, I am surprised, become better. He was had a problem of hearing because the nerve tumor was so nice, I could then really preserve the cochlear. And he said, I can hear much better. 81 years old.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor. Thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
Thank you, Professor Wozniak, for these questions. Dr. Dilshad Mamadaliev, you have a question.
Yes, thank you so much, dear Professor Sami. It was a great pleasure to listen in your lectures. You were also one of the best inspiration for young neurosurgeons like us. So my question, I have had many questions, but most of them were answered so far. And my question is about the period of reconstruction of facial nerve. So when we have complication after schwannoma surgery, in what period of reconstruction is the best? I mean, yes, we can do it at the earliest period, but the latest period, what is the latest period? Like 5 years, 10 years is also possible, or which is the permissible frame?
I think this is a very important general question, because this timing, we have to think about different issues. One is when you did operation and the patient come out and has a facial pulse, but you have the feeling I preserved the facial, but the patient has a complete facial pulse. My advice is in these cases, at least you have to wait 1 year, at least. But I would recommend to do in these cases, if patient is available, every 3 months an EMG, you know, to see if some fibers are coming. If you see that, for example, some fibers is coming after 3 months, and so you can be sure it will recover. And so this is, and I would say decision making for reconstruction or do anything for facial nerve, not before 1.5 years. 1 year waiting, another 6 months as a security, you know, because in human body, you never know how different they are. But if 1.5 year, nothing is coming, then you make decision, hypoglossal facial, or whatever, what you want to do. This is for that. But in which case you are allowed to do it, if after how many years? I told in my lecture, please do always an electromyogram. And if you do electromyogram, question to the neurophysiologist, please see if there is, how is the spontaneous activities of the muscles of the side? Is it strong? is very little. And this will give you some idea about fibrosis of the facial. But you ask in the same time, please look if there is a mixed innervation. Because through the mixed innervation, you can have, even after 5 years, you have seen the girl I operated as a child, 5 months, 19 years, she recovered. But the recovery of this patient double so long. Keep in your mind. That means if you have somebody that 5 years, 10 years, or so, the normal recovery of facial nerve, you will see 7 months after the reconstruction, the first EMG positive, or even the people start to move a little. Seven, and then go up to 1.5 year, better and better and better. And therefore, this when the patient has good stone tonus activity, doesn't look at the time, go and do the surgery, and you will be successful. And by the way, another fact, I remember 25 years ago, I have evaluated all my hypoglossofacial anastomosis, and my colleagues, who was my co-author, and examined, and he wrote three cases that these three cases has not a good function. I say, come on, I want to know all these three patients. I got all the name, and I asked my secretary, please contact them, they should come to me. I want to see by myself, because I can. Believe me, this is so important, therefore I am explaining to you. The patient come one was working in agriculture, was not interested. He doesn't use one time any exercise and any, because when you are using the hypoglossal nerve, you have to make the real exercise. And he said, Professor, no problem. I'm happy. I said, come on here. And I try half an hour to make exercise with the same person. I said, please put your tongue to the things. And during half an hour, he started to move the face. I tell you, for all colleagues who are listening to me, how important is the post-operative rehabilitation and so. And therefore, all three was success, and only the people couldn't use it. And this is a very, very important question you are doing. You see, with question, you can solve many problems that you cannot in your lecture explain everything.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. And I see Dr. Joe E. Sam raised his hand.
Hi, thank you, Professor Majid Sami. Great lecture. Actually, you partially answered my question. I wanted to ask post-operatively, what was your regime for the patients after they have done the surgery for facial nerve reconstruction? Is it just simple physiotherapy? Are there any medications or adjuncts or any other methods that you use to help these patients recover faster? Thank you.
Very important, very, very important. Why? The most important rehabilitation and regeneration of facial nerve is that the fibers, there are 1,000 fibers, they are going through the distal to the graft and to the distal part of the nerve. They don't know where they are going. They go and they reach the end organ. But it is very important, please be always very sensitive for that, because the question is so important. The patient has to learn in the training, not only stay for the mirror and make like this all the time. This is not a training. The training must be absolutely clarified to the patient that each region has to be moved separately. With this, you can avoid the synergistic effect, because when the patient want to move the leg and they close the eye, you know, and it's not good for the patient. The patient is suffering from that. But they have to hold. You have to tell them, hold, for example, this part, your face, in front of the mirror, and try 100 times, close the eye, that this part is not moving. Why? The brain learned that for this, the center, which part, which cells in the brain should be activated, you know? Because once this is not moving, the brain knows, they can understand that it's moving only this stuff. And then using the fiber new for this action. The same is hold the eye and start these to move. And this is something absolutely for the refinement of the recovery. Therefore, your question is, I am thankful to you for this question, because I cannot explain all these things in a lecture, you know. It's, otherwise, I must talk 5 hours about the facial nerve. Absolute correct what you say. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Prof.
By the way, electrostimulation, forget it. You know, that's it. Electrostimulation 3 times a week, 10 minutes, that is nothing. Also for peripheral nerve, also you can't forget. If you develop an instrument, you can put it here, and every 5 minutes it is stimulating, okay. But selective stimulation, if you stimulate the facial nerve here and everything move, is not good.
Thank you very much.
You are welcome. You are welcome.
Is there any other question? Professor Yokokato, do you want to say something?
Thank you very much for excellent lecture, as always. I want to ask one question. We have the many cranial nerves, but which nerve is, the strongest in your experiences? Because recently we have the fourth nerve schwannoma, just front of the brainstem, but still it's the patient has not recovery good, well. So I think which cranial nerve is tolerate invasion, this I want to know from you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, my dear Yoko, this is a very, very difficult, question, because we distinguish between 2 types of the nerve. Nerve which are continuation of the brain, the nerve and has no Schwann cells. There are 2 nerves. One is the optic nerve, and the other is olfactory nerve. These 2 nerves, they are very sensitive, because they don't have Schwann cells. They have no protection of Schwann cells. But in the CP angle, we have the 2 nerves, which is coming from brainstem. One is the 8, one is the 7. If you look in the histology of these both nerves, the facial nerve has a central part, perhaps 1-2 millimeter, not more. But the 8th nerve has a length of continuation of the brain about 10-12 millimeters. That means in CP angle, the first nerve, which is involved when there is a tumor and has clinical symptom, is vertigo or hearing loss. They are very sensitive, but the facial nerve is very strong compared to these 2. That is the only thing what I can tell you. But I believe the same is true for abducens and also for the other, the trochlearis nerve. And of course, one thing I would generally say in the caudal cranial nerve, you know, that for example, the vagus and glossopharyngeus, they have a lot of vegetative fibers, which have also completely different function. They are a little bit more weak than compared to facial nerve, so that the people start to get then swallowing problem, you know, and or they have some voice problem, and so that is the probably the when we want to make a category of the different nerves, you know. So, but facial nerve is strong. You have seen, Yoko, you have seen 5 centimeter large or longer vestibular schwannoma that has no facial nerve, tolerates so long, but is almost deaf or had a long history of vertigo or something. You know, very, very important question, but very difficult.
Okay, thanks. Thanks so much.
You're welcome.
Albert?
Yes, thank you very much, Professor Yoko Kato. If there are no other questions from the audience, I want to thank very much Professor Sami.
May I say something?
Yes, please.
I want to congratulate you and Yoko Kato very much for this type of education. This is the now real education. All people were participating in this now lecture. They have received informations, not directly from me, also from the questions, from discussions. Therefore, I hope in future we will not have any other type of education program than this. If we have the chance, if I have the chance to listen to someone who has all his life dedicated to this, his specialty, and we can ask him question and we can take from him and we give him, you have 10 minutes time to talk, and the next one come who has not 1% of the experiences and they have also 10 minutes time to talk, this is not acceptable. We had an education program with Professor Kato and Professor Neil Martin and Balsavias. 3 hours we discuss, Yoko, you remember, 3 hours we discuss about aneurysm. Another 3 hours we discuss about AVM, but it still was not, but at the end, everything was discussed and everybody was happy, and they have, and therefore I congratulate you for this meeting. Please go on, continue, and if you need any help, I will support you.
Thank you, Professor Sami, for this endorsement, and we are really grateful also for your availability. As you said, we can ask your advice also in the future. I'm pretty sure we will need to, so thank you very much. And we are particularly grateful because we learned a lot from you today, and because you spared more than 1.5 hours on Sunday morning, actually during lunchtime here in Europe. So thank you so much, because you have been very, very nice to all of us. I think young neurosurgeons will always be grateful to you also for this educational course you gave us today. So thank you very much. You are invited, of course, to stay for the next lecture, but we understand if you have to leave because
I can listen to the
Thank you very much.
I heard it's 15 minutes, it's a research program.
Yeah. Right.
With pleasure.
Thank you, Professor Sami. Thank you. Bye-bye. So I would like to ask my co-moderator, Professor Ishu Bishnoi, to introduce our next speaker.
Thank you, dear Alberto. And my sincere regards, Professor Sami.
And thank you for the lecture. So I would like to invite Dr. Mari Kusumi for the next lecture, which will be on my strategies for meningioma and skull-based meningioma surgery. She is currently working as associate professor at Department of Neurosurgery, Kita Sato University School of Medicine. She has special interest in meningiomas and skull-based tumors. She has published some special techniques for the meningioma surgeries. And she is a board certified neurosurgeon, and she has been there, worked as a director of neurosurgery. So I would like to ask Dr. Mari Kusumi to present his presentation.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
And can you see my PC yes. now?
Okay.
Yes.
Professor Bishanoi, thank you for introducing me.
Thank you.
スライリハーサル、どうやっけな。スライドしよう、これか。Firstly, I would like to thank Professor Yoko Kato and Professor Alberto Ferretti for inviting me to this great opportunity. And I'm very honored to speak with Professor Sami. I would like to begin my presentation with about surgery for meningioma and skull-based meningiomas. It's for young neurosurgeons. Regarding surgical indications of meningioma, as you know, the meningioma are 90% benign. So surgical indication should be strict. The indications are the case with neurosurgical disorder or growing or skull-based meningioma location at young patient. For basic surgical technique is 4D technique. Dr. Fukushima always mentioned this importance. 4D techniques include the vascularized flow of feeding arteries, detachment from dural attachment, the internal debulking, and then resection from normal structures. In addition, meningioma are growing from attachments on the dura and involving surrounding structures. For removal, it should be returned to the attachment. I show you a short video of 42 years female. This tumor located at middle fossa, and the feeding artery from internal carotid and external carotid artery. But we skipped embolization because I think this is, I can make mastoidectomy and a coagulation of dura for extradurally. We can detachment and devascularize first. Now I open the dura and devascularize tumor completely intradurally. And that time I trying to internal debulking via subtemporal route, but it's not good corridor. So I decide to make transcortical route. Now tumor is almost convexity, so it's easy to make internal debulking and resection from temporal lobe. Then now the tumor was, I take tumor Simpson grade 1 removal, but this tumor is unfortunately WHO grade 2 meningioma. So after surgery, we plan to radiation therapy for this patient. Patient recovered very well. I'm moving on surgical strategy for skull-based meningiomas. For preparations, preoperatively, embolization of feeding artery and skull-based technique are considered. Skull-based meningiomas are divided into frontal base and posterior fossa. Frontal skull-based meningioma include tuberculum sera, sphenoid-rich mainly, which required anteroclinoidectomy and optic canal unroofing as usual. Posterior fossa meningioma include petrochloral and foramen magnum meningioma. which require a transpetrosal or transcondylar host approach if needed. But recently, for central skull-based meningioma, endoscopic transsphenoidal skull-based surgery has been selected. I believe the point of surgery is to avoid crossing nerve and perforators for safety. For WHO grade 1 skull-based meningioma, incomplete resection was reported to be the only risk of recurrence. So we should make maximum resection. For lateral type, I do usually craniotomy and some kind of skull-based technique for this tumor. For central skull-based meningioma, endoscopic transsphenoidal surgery should be considered, but in clypeus region, it's difficult to make dural reconstruction, so I have no experience to take this tumor, but in near future, I will do. I show you operation video of 47 years sphenoid-rich meningioma. This patient presented only with headache, but tumor is engulfed the arteries, and this feeding artery is only from internal carotid artery. Because of this small feeding, we skipped embolization. Patient placed in supine position and head rotated to 15 degree to right side, left side, sorry. Firstly, I do extradural anterior crinoidectomy. First, I cut a meningopital band and dura propria was elevated from superorbital fissure. I done optic canal unlooping, followed by anterior crinoidectomy. It's all done. So I opened the dura and distal transiluvian approach was performed to expose the tumors. Then I cut the dura to open the optic canal to find optic nerve. But this time tumor is very hard to, it's difficult to find optic safety cutting line. So I switched to do internal debulking first. So olfactory nerve was fine and I dissection tumor from frontal base. Then I'm detaching the tumor from near optic canal. I'm looking for the optic nerve I found here. So now I understand I can cut the lateral part of the optic canal and I found the optic nerve. This bone is a remaining anterior crinoid. I take it. And this patient is sphenoparietal sinus is almost occluded. So I decide to cut this vein and remove the lateral part of the tumor, making tumor smaller and tumor is returned to the attachment. And lateral part of the tumor is safe to remove. And when I dissecting the around vessel, it's important to do not coagulate the tumor and keep arachnoid intact. So I found M1 now and make gradually tumor smaller, piecemeal removal, and I found internal carotid artery. Fortunately, this patient arachnoid was intact. So tumor was gathered to the attachment and tumor is very hard, so I need a scissors. And this one is the last piece of the tumor. So I gradually pulled this tumor to the attachment. I found a promoter nerve and take it. So Simpson grade 2 removal was completed. and I preserved all important structures. So meningioma on petroglyphal regions, the relationship between 7 and 8 nerves and in the cisternal portion and the tumor determines the approaches. If 7 and 8 nerves is not dorsal size of the meningioma, lateral suboccipital approach is chosen. However, tumor invades the Meckel cave or 7 and 8 nerve on the dorsal side of meningiomas, I will choose transpetrosal approach. I know Dr. Professor Sami published supramedial approach. It's a very nice approach, but it's difficult for hard tumors. It's good for the soft tumor in sitting position, I think. And also we should consider about venous drainage pattern. In Hacker's classification, capenous type and transcortical type is good for the transpetrosal approach, but transbasal or spinopalatal type, spinobasal or spinopalatal type is requiring the special care to preserve the venous drainage. I'm some examination was shows this examination. This is a small petrotentorial region. This tumor is located above the 7 and 8 nerve, so I choose lateral suboccipital approach. We don't need to touch the 7 and 8 nerves because tumor is upper side of the 5th nerve. But this is next case is almost same size, but this is spinotentorial meningioma. And this meningioma is located on ventral side of the 7 and 8 nerve. So if you choose the lateral suboccipital approach, you need to cross the 7 and 8 nerve. So I choose anterior transpetrosal approach. Next, I show the big case, big petroglyphal regions. This patient have already left 6 nerve palsy and right hemiparesis. This tumor is extended upper side, so and tumor is a little bit big, so and it looks hard, so I choose combined transpetrosal approach. Main feeder is from external carotid and the internal carotid, so I ask the endovascular guy to embolize these tumors. This patient venous drainage pattern is cavernous type and it's good for the petrosal approach. But this patient have a subtemporal venous drainage, so it is a little bit concerned. Previously, I and Dr. Fukushima published tentorial detachment technique. This is for huge petroglyphal meningioma. It's a good approach to detachment and devascularize first to take the tentorium. But for posterior side cut is sacrifice of the superior petrosal vein. So I modify now, do not cut posterior side, only cut anterior side to protect the superior petrosal veins. But for this technique is good, still effective for the huge meningioma because for huge one, as usual, superior petrosal vein is occluded. I show the last case of the petroglyphal meningioma. I show this time. Already mastoidectomy was done, so I cut the anterior tentorium to protect the force nerve. I'm doing the detachment and the vascularize, and then I do internal debulking and dissection from the surround structures. And this time for the technique is half to mixed ordered. Now I'm opening the dural sleeve of tentorium of force nerve. This procedure to make force nerve mobilization. So now I'm taking the upper side of the tumor. I think this combined transpetrosal approach is a good procedure for in this hard tumors. Now upper side of dural attachment I cut and I found operomotor nerve. In this operative field, only fifth nerve is center on the operative field. We don't need crossing the nerve except fifth nerve, so this approach is very safe for the cranial nerves. Now I found sixth nerve in cisternal portion. This patient already has a sixth nerve palsy, so I was taking maximum care to preserve this nerve now. But the tumor is very hot here and stick to the abducens nerve, so some piece of the tumor was left near the Doyle's canal. Still, I'm checking the electronic device and I confirm sixth nerve working. I'm trying to dissect the tumor from the brainstem, but this tumor adhered to the brainstem. It's difficult to dissect this tumor from the brainstem to keep the vein on the brainstem, so I left some piece of the tumor on the brainstem. So nearly total dissection was done. And this patient, sixth nerve palsy is getting worse temporarily, but it was completely recovered for 6 months later. And also subtemporal venous drainage is protected. This angioma is grade one, so now we are following up on MRI. Conclusion for meningioma surgery. It is important to observe the operation indications for the technique and manipulation to return it to the attachment. The strategy is the same as for scar-based meningiomas, but those tumors for the technique need to be done in a mixed order to preserve nerve and vessels. Thank you.
Thank you for the wonderful presentation, Dr. Mari Kusumi. So the panel is open for the discussion.
Yes.
If anybody has question, they can ask.
I have a question issue for Dr. Kusumi. Congratulations, Dr. Kusumi, for this wonderful presentation. You showed the very interesting cases and difficult cases. Do you always do angiography, AGF, before surgery? And how do you decide when you want to do preoperative embolization of this tumor, if you do preoperative embolization? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your questions. Preoperatively, I take the CT angiography first. So if CT angiography feeding a lot of feeders, I decide to do angiography. Or tumor is, suspected to be some compression of the veins, I decide to do angiography. And as usual, if I do a combined transpetrosal approach, I usually try to do, ask end vascular guide to embolize preoperatively. Because for combined transpetrosal approach, just drilling a bone, it's bleeding sometimes. But for preoperative embolization, reduce the bleeding.
Thank you. Thank you.
So Dr. Atik Islam, you can ask.
Oh, thank you, Professor, for your nice lecture. I have a small question. That is, during combined petrosal approach, what is your steps of reconstruction of the dural defect? Do you put some partial data or something else?
Thank you for your question. Yes, previously I published with Dr. Fukushima. We use a first year latter, but now I switch to abdominal fat only. Only just dural defect. I put Duragen and abdominal fat, and only little bit, two or three stitch to do not move the abdominal fat. That's only.
Okay. My another question is, what is your suggestion to deal with the cases of glomus jugulari, which is highly vascular? Do you recommend some preoperative embolization or you directly land on the tumor?
I can understand your question. Please say again, please. Sorry.
Glomus jugulari. Surgery of glomus
Glomus jugulari.
Which is highly vascular sometimes.
Yeah, highly vascular, yes.
And do you recommend some preoperative embolization, then tumor removal, or you directly go for surgery?
Yeah. Sorry, I have no experience of jugulari tumors, but I heard about other experts. He said embolization is must for this vascular tumor. But nowadays, maybe that kind of tumor is very sensitive to the radiation. So it's difficult to, do surgical indications now.
Okay, thank you.
So we have two questions from Dr. Harshad Parekh. For you, Dr. Kusumi. First is pre-op embolization help to reduce bleeding?
What?
Does pre-op embolization help in reducing bleeding?
Yes. Preoperative, preoperative embolization reduced tumor feeding. And it's also reduced the tumor drainage to the vein. It's reduced the draining blood to the veins. So it's good for the just for craniotomy. It make works.
Okay, his second question is, which feeders you find safe to embolize? Which feeders of the tumor?
Thank you, it's good. But I'm not endovascular person, so I'm not sure, but as usual, endovascular person can embolize internal carotid artery. But for external carotid artery, sometimes it's connected to the facial nerve or sometimes, especially for ascending pharyngeal artery, is dangerous anastomosis to the foramen magnum. So they are usually do not embolize ascending pharyngeal artery, but middle meningeal or other portion, they before embolization they checked some Kishirokine test, anesthesia test. And they do the embolize as much as possible, as usual.
Okay.
Okay.
So
there is one question I want to ask. Like after pre-op embolization, have you ever encountered increase in the swelling of the tumor and the surgery became worsened because of the embolization went to the venous drainage and led to disastrous consequences?
Thank you for question. Fortunately, I have no experience about that, but if they occlude venous drainage, it's very dangerous, I think. So just for, you know, preoperative embolization, if it's dangerous, they should stop to embolize. So not so, I have no experience to so much dangerous situations.
Okay, and another thing is, in your first surgical video, the heart-shaped tumor, which was arising above the tentorium, you did the corticectomy and removed the tumor. And yes. I noticed that there was a large vein, which was you put some cotinoids and
I think we have some connection issue. We have some connection problems with you. Okay, now probably you can ask again your question.
Yeah. Sorry. Sorry for the glitch. In doing corticectomy, you push the vessel downward, the vein, which was pushed down. Did you get that?
Yeah, at that time, that portion of the, that tumor near vein of Lapé is running. So elevation of the temporal lobe is difficult. It was, Lapé is regulation to elevate the temporal lobe. So it's safe to make corticotomy to save the veins. I think a venous congestion is most dangerous side effect of the for the tumor resection. So I think to protect venous drainage is most important for post-operative care.
Okay, so the question is like, have you ever encountered that because the veins, they are very delicate and sometimes they get damaged. So in your experience, these dangerous veins, like major veins, if they get damaged, then the consequences of venous infarct and the cerebral edema, local site cerebral edema, and all those things. Have you encountered such kind of case and how did you manage those cases?
Oh, those cases. Usually I protect the vein, so I do not cut the vein. So I have not so much experience of so dangerous situation, but if it had, if it happened, maybe I make general anesthesia to the patient. I make patient deep coma, use drug. And I do, you know, a ventilation for the patient.
Thank you very much. Any more questions?
Maybe issue we can, as we are so lucky to have Professor Sami still joining us, maybe we can ask him to give a comment or some suggestions.
I enjoyed very much. I would like to congratulate you for making such surgeries. My congratulations. They are really tough surgeries and with enormous risk. And of course, the question is always in which school you have learned doing these skull base, you know, and that is a school that people use the Petrus ball to enter in the medial fossa, in the posterior fossa, and petrosectomy. My late friend Cavas was also very, very interested in that field and did also pioneer work over many years. I have found that some phenomenon which I would like then perhaps to give further to you. One is when we start with the first with tumors which are in petrochloral region and entering into the cave of Meckel or the, in the middle fossa. And I have done so many cases, you know, of middle fossa approach and petrodectomy and so. And finally, I found that they are in the, if we have the option between approach to the middle fossa or approach with a CP angle to this pathology, I saw that the risk of complications, bleeding and everything is much less when you learn to go to the CP angle and don't touch the temporal lobe. The temporal lobe is really an absolute risk for the patients, for the epilepsy. And as she said, and that is very correctly, she said that I am afraid to elevate the temporal lobe to create venous rupture and other complications. And that is indeed one of the reasons why I have absolutely then abandoned the approaches of the temporal approach to the petrochloral region, because when I can come with a CP angle and reach the petrous apex, and I can also from CP angle remove the entire tentorium. So see in the middle fossa, tentorium has no function. We can remove it, and you can see that there is no, it's better tentorium removal than the go through that entire petrous bone, you know. This is something that it is, I tell you, that the problem is, if you want to use this philosophy of mine, you have to learn with lot of cases of CP angle approaches to be absolutely sure in CP angle. When you are not absolutely sure in CP angle, I think the only way is to go through the temporal petrous bone. Otherwise, in CP angle, you can create a lot of also complication when you have not done. And the abducens nerve, she has very nicely discussed about that. I found that is, I have a wonderful video, there are several videos, that if you come in a meningioma, in petrochloral tumor extended in the, I would say, cave of Meckel, the beauty of CP angle is that you enucleate the tumor and then you can identify the sixth nerve at brainstem, which you cannot identify by subtemporal approach. You see that at the end, but you see that. And when you see that in the beginning, then slowly, slowly, you can remove the tumor and you see even the dorsal of canal. Yeah, dorsal canal, you can see that, how the nerve enter into the dorsal canal. And then it is absolutely safe. And this is, of course, many advantages that I have compared these two both possibilities, which I have done many, many of them. In the beginning, also at least in 70, that was my approach. I removed from above subtemporal. I removed also petrous apex. That is the first time I did it in 70s in order to come to the clivus and in CP angle from above, you know. But I had these complications with the venous hemorrhage. I had the complication of, so many Sony epilepsy cases of the temporal lobe and so. And then I tried to go to the CP angle from there to do it. This is something that I think she should slowly, slowly try to use more encourage to go supra-metal. And from this, I am sure with the technique you have, you are able absolutely to do that over the years, perhaps the next 4 or 5 years, to solve all these problems with a supramental approach without going through the entire petrous bone or to expose that area. I think this is not easy. I think if you have not that experience with a CP angle in that way, you need to go through this way what was described. And the other thing which I would like to say about the medial sphenoid wing meningioma, you can make your life so easy that you don't go along the sphenoid wing, because I know from also many colleagues, Fukushima and the other colleagues, that they have had so many complications with the rupture of carotid arteries, because the tumor is all the carotid arteries is severed. When you want to coagulate the feeding vessels along the sphenoid wing, you are risking to perhaps make some really complication, which is not necessary. If you plan your surgery that you can go later along the sphenoid wing, but open the sylvian fissure from beginning, your surgery is only opening fissure. Then when you open the surgery and you try in the sylvian fissure, find one arteries of middle cerebral artery, which is available. And you make enucleation and follow these arteries down, 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 and you come to the carotid artery. And the tumor is enucleated, the optic nerve is decompressed, everything. If then you want to make drilling of the sphenoid wing and open the optic nerve and so on, you can do it. But safely you land slowly, slowly to the... I have found this solution already 45 years ago in my skull-based book. Please look at that. There are many drawings about this technique what I'm explaining to you. It makes my life so easy that I am not worried about medial sphenoid wing, because I open sylvian fissure, I have the meningioma there, and then I go slowly down, and at the end I can clean everything. This is, and also oculomotor nerve and everything come later. And this is something what I would say, but I know at that time everybody was talking about coagulation of the feeding vessel along the sphenoid wing in order to make the tumor less bloody, but on the other side have so many complications, you know. And therefore there is no need for this medial sphenoid wing. If you want to make, in the past I did always embolization with Professor Valamanis for the all meningioma, but I am not doing anymore because there is really very special cases that you have in MRI, see that there are a lot of vascularization, but it is not always meningioma, so many vascularization. Then you can do embolization. And this is perhaps one, but I wanted really to congratulate you doing such absolute difficult cases. Bravo, bravo, bravo. This is really, that makes me so happy. But please accept my advice. Try your activity in CP angle, approach to tentorium and to cave of Meckel. And from there, I have, if you wish, I can show you many, many videos how they solve the problem. But my congratulations again. I am proud that our ladies, neurosurgeon, they are so tough and doing so difficult cases. Bravo. That is my comment, nothing else. But some little advice. Yeah.
Thank you very much for Professor Sami. I'm very pleasure to talk with you. And I know you as a, you know, expert. So I followed your book, your literature. I study a lot. Thank you so much, your comment.
Thank you, Professor Sami, for your comments. And we also have Professor Wozniak already still connected, if he wants to give his comments.
Professor Sami, may I say goodbye, because yes, I have a meeting I have to lose, but I enjoyed very much to listen to the meningioma lecture. Again, my congratulations to all of you. Please go. Thank you very much. Bye bye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Professor Sami. Oh, it's quite difficult to be next to Professor Sami to discuss and comment something up to him. So, but fortunately, I agree with the maestro. So, yeah, Dr. Kazumi, you showed really excellent surgery, and my congratulations. It's great. But I'd like to warn you in doing surgery, like when you perform approach and sake of approach, some of your tumors you show could be removed with the more safe and smaller approaches, less dangerous and less traumatic. Anyway, every neurosurgeon takes a decision which approach to choose regarding his experience, regarding his skills and in sake of for the patient, first of all. So if you are confident, if you can do it, please do it. But in my practice, I step over this some years back and came to more less traumatic approaches. Less traumatic, not keyhole, but smaller, faster, and more effective with the same result. Concerning embolization, I completely agree with Professor Sami that only minority of meningiomas require to be embolized, because most of meningioma get arterial blood supply from the system of external carotids, and the majority of branches of external carotids are available during our surgical approach, when we perform the approach in the surgery, and first what we do, we vascularize it. About extradural root for sphenoid wing meningioma, I usually start extradurally. Why? Because I can coagulate middle meningeal artery. Usually, it's a main feeder for sphenoid wing meningioma. Once you coagulate it and cut it, you devascularize the tumor for 70-80% before even touching it. And I agree that in my practice, I really start from extradural, and I agree with you, Dr. Kasumi, in this point. But in general, thank you very much. Great cases, great surgery. Hope to see you in person and in the future. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your comment. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. But for extradural anatomy, it's much easier to understand where the, you know, where optic nerve is. So as usual, I do extradural approach first to find normal anatomy.
Yes.
Thank you.
And let me comment, when to avoid the carotid injury, mm-hmm. I find it the internal carotid in the cavernous sinus, and then go along it like you do. So thank you. This excellent technique, and I think it's safe. This technique is safe. It's effective. Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Professor Kusumi, there is one more question from Dr. Karimo.
Yes.
He's asking how much time you perform your surgery after endovascular embolization.
Oh, as usual, within three days, not same days. Some person choose endovascular surgery and open surgery do same days, but mm-hmm. I didn't do that. Because I want to start my surgery morning. So okay. at least yesterday, yeah, embolization can be done.
Yes. And can you elaborate, why don't you take more days?
Yeah, sometimes I'm not experienced, but sometimes after embolization, meningioma can be make hemorrhage. Yeah. So, yeah, so embolization operation day and embolization must be close. But 2 or 3 days, it's okay for the patient because they are in Japan, they can stay in the hospital and we can watch the patient.
Okay. And there is one more question. What material is used for embolization?
Usually they use NBCA or use an NBCA and coil.
Okay. Yes, it is the material. Thank you. So are there any more questions? So thank you for the wonderful lecture. So Professor Yoko, can you give us final comments?
Yes, yes. Kusumi-sensei, thank you very much for your wonderful lecture. And my remembrance, I think she attended so many workshops in US or some other foreign places. And also that she watched the surgery very carefully, I think. Then now is she is one of the best chief of the, especially the skull base, the tumor in Japan. Kitasato University is one of the big university in Tokyo.
No, it's more small university, but thank you very much for Professor Yoko Kato. I'm very pleased to work with you.
Thanks a lot. So I think maybe the younger generation, I think that you can follow her attitude, how that she learned the skull-based surgery. Yes, very, very precise, I think, technique during that she showed three cases, but it was it's really wonderful, I think. So conversation, so do your best in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your comment, Professor Kato.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you so much.
Already, Dr. Sami has left. I think we had a very good the two lectures today. So already it's over the 2 hours. Webinar, so we should finish, I think. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you very much, Professor Kato, for these final comments. I think it's no need to add more. Thank you, Professor Sami, who left but gave us a really impressive lecture. Dr. Mari Kusumi, thank you so much. We learned a lot about meningiomas and skull-based surgery, and congratulations, really, you are performing great surgeries. Thank you to Professor Alexander Wozniak for his wonderful comments. And thank you, Professor Yoko Kato, of course. And thank you, special thanks to my co-moderator, Ishu Bishnoi. Thank you for your help. So see you next time. Have a nice day or night.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, Alexander. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Bye.
Goodbye,
thank
everyone.
You. See you next time.
ありがとうございました。ありがとうございました。ありがとうございました。ありがとうございました。素晴らしかったです。ありがとうございます。ありがとうございます。みんなに教えてやってください。ありがとうございます。そうします。ありがとうございます。